had an unfortunate problem with recording the sermon yesterday. It did not record, so I'm going to do it again here in the backyard. Not quite the scenic view that we have of the beach from Romar Beach Baptist Church, but hopefully this will work out. Had several members who weren't able to make it. Several regular attenders weren't there as well. Just a tough weekend for everybody, and I want to make sure that everybody gets this. And plus, this is a whole series on the Gospel of Mark, and I didn't want any part missing. So this won't be exactly the same as it was yesterday in church. But here we go. I'm reading from Mark chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. We'll just look at those two verses today, although we're going to add in more. You'll see. And immediately, the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered unto him. Mark was the first of the Gospels that was written and circulated to that first generation of Christians. Mark faithfully gave us a great summary of the ministry of Jesus Christ as it was remembered and taught and preached by the Apostle Peter. It is an inspired work, and it forms the basis for the Gospels of both Matthew and Luke. Both of these Gospels, written later, used Mark for their outline as they filled in more of the background and in some cases more of the details about the life of Jesus and some of his sermons. John's Gospel does not follow the same narrative flow, but also deals with many of the same events. In the scriptures we just read, Matthew gives us some more information. Luke adds in some important details as well. One of my ongoing personal study projects is to take this kind of comparison. It's what the scholars call the harmony of the Gospels. And I like to look at what all of the writings say together when more than one especially is dealing with an episode in the life or the ministry of Jesus. Mark was most concerned with the ministry that Jesus performed. And Mark's work is concise. It's very direct. Matthew and Luke, written later and probably to some extent to fulfill a need, and the Holy Spirit directed them to write more about some of the things that happened to Jesus, and we learn from them by his perfect example. Mark told us what happened. Later, people were wanting to know how did it happen, and then by the time John came along, writing his gospel, thinking back some 60 or 70 years later on it, the profound old man came in and told us a lot of the why about the things that happened in the life of Jesus. Now, he didn't speak specifically to this, so we're going to fill in some details from Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11, and some interjections from Luke, also chapter 4, and verses 1 through 13. We're going to be looking at the temptation of Jesus that immediately followed his baptism. When Jesus came up out of the water after John baptized him in the River Jordan, he saw the heavens opened up. And that is a sight just so glorious, so holy, it would strike a sinful man like me or a person like you dead. Just dead. Like the wrath of an atomic fire. The Holy Spirit is not to be trifled with. The power of Almighty God in all of his perfection is something that we sinful creatures can't withstand. It's only by the blood of Jesus and his perfection that we're going to be able to see that one day ourselves. But at that time, this was the sight that Jesus saw, the incredible vistas of eternity and the throne of God and the glory of heaven. And right after that, the Holy Spirit came down like a dove upon him, and then, for all to hear, the voice of Almighty God himself thundered from above, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Jesus, to fulfill all righteousness, had John baptize him, and John wanted to be baptized by Jesus instead. Jesus wanted to make sure that everybody who would come afterwards, who came to believe in him, would understand that this is an important act of faith. Once you believe in him and are born again, you should publicly profess that. And the baptism ceremony, the ordinance of baptism, is something that we do as Christians. When we have come to accept Christ, it gives us a great opportunity to proclaim to the world, I am leaving my old sinful life behind and embarking upon a new life, following Jesus, born again in the Spirit of God. Jesus, to fulfill all righteousness, had John baptize him. John wanted to be baptized by Jesus instead, but Jesus wanted to fulfill all righteousness in doing this. And by that, what the Bible is telling us is that Jesus wanted every believer who would come after him to also be baptized. And so he didn't leave them with any excuse. If he was going to be baptized, then everybody else needed to be baptized as well. Now, in the Baptist faith, the baptism is an ordinance, but we don't hold that as being a prerequisite for salvation. In other words, we don't tell you that you're not saved until you're baptized, but we certainly believe that if you are saved, you ought to be baptized. What that is that's what's called a public profession of faith. You are telling the world you are not ashamed of Jesus, and you are leaving your old life behind in that water. You are coming up out of that water a new creature with a new spirit given to you. You are born again in the Spirit of God, and that's what coming up out of that water means as a symbol of your new life in Christ. Now, Jesus, of course, wasn't symbolizing leaving behind an old life of sin for a new life of repentance, as we should all do, but what he was doing was leaving behind childhood, youthful obligations, his study, his time of preparation, his time of apprenticeship, his time of obligations to his family, all of those things he was leaving behind now and embarking on his new life and ministry publicly as the Son of God, as the Messiah, as Christ the Lord. As Jesus began his ministry, he entered into his service in the kingdom of heaven with a boot camp that was worse than any recruit ever endured entering into military service. Let me read to you from Matthew chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, and I'm going to interject with some of the other scripture that apply to what happened when Jesus went off into the wilderness. Then Jesus was led, being full of the Holy Spirit, as Luke tells us, and was driven immediately into the wilderness with the wild beasts, as Mark tells us. And Matthew tells us that there was temptation of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was famished afterwards. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If you are the Son of God, command these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said to him, If you are the Son of God, cast yourself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest at any time you dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, It is written again, You shall not tempt the Lord your God. Again, the devil took him up into an exceedingly high mountain, and as Luke tells us, in a moment of time, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and said to him, All this power will I give you, and their glory, for that is delivered to me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. If you fall down and worship me, all shall be yours. Then Jesus told him, You get out of here, Satan, for it is written, You shall worship the Lord your God, and only him shall you serve. Then Luke says, when the devil had ended all the temptation, he left him for a season, and behold, angels came and cared for him. Right after the baptism of Jesus, Luke tells us that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. Now, it's not unheard of for Christians to experience a great sense of the filling of the Holy Spirit following the ordinance of baptism. That's a supernatural thing, not just an emotional high. Mark tells us that Jesus was driven immediately into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit. You see, at times like that, in the life of a Christian, when we know that we are overshadowed by the presence of the Holy Spirit, when we are filled with the Holy Ghost, in those moments when we receive some kind of instruction or guidance or command from God, we should be quick to act upon it. We should also not delude ourselves that an emotional high is the same thing, or that God would ever tell us to do anything through the Holy Ghost that would ever conflict with the Bible. Nor should we necessarily think that our own bright ideas and desires is what God's will is for us, and we should be hesitant to make that claim. There at Romar Beach Baptist Church, we often have ministers and others who will send us their resumes or who will come up to one or more of us on staff after the service and say words to the effect, I'm paraphrasing here, I think God wants me to be on staff here. I've got some great ideas that you guys have probably never thought of. I'm certain I can make this ministry take off with the latest and best methods that the church industry has to offer. Now, I don't really know what is going on in the heads of some of these guys who stroll up and proclaim they are the answer. Now, maybe they imagine that that church is a great place to maybe recycle some of their old sermons between golf outings. Perhaps they look at that building down there on the beach and they think, some millionaires must have built this. We have heard that before out of the mouths of people. And maybe they imagine the paycheck that a staff member must draw there at Romar Beach Baptist. And let me tell you, it's really very humble for all of us. And our head pastor doesn't make a penny. He doesn't get any compensation at all. I have to wonder how well they would think they had heard from God if they knew that this place has an incredible mortgage that we never know from month to month how God will meet it. That's not a complaint. That's a praise of the power and faithfulness of God. And there are plenty of people who think that ministry is an opportunity for good money and soft work, especially in a tourist destination town. But like every other operation down here on the beach, we are understaffed, underfinanced, overworked, and dependent upon the changes of the seasons. This little island here is not like the average rural or suburban or urban population. Autumn and winter are very lean times of the year in a seasonal vacation town. And a small mission church with a lot of overhead in a vacation town is no vacation. I am not so sure of the fellow who presents himself out of nowhere as the answer to questions that nobody down here is asking. I am much more impressed, however, with the people who have come to us one at a time, two at a time, small families who have moved down here near the beach for one reason or another. They've got a job already, and despite the challenges of a big church ministry with a mission church staff and a small church congregation, they still come up after they have seen what's going on and figure it out, and they still come and they'll say, if y'all will have me, I think God wants me to serve here, to join this fellowship, to be a part of this church family, and serve Jesus any way I can. Now, how do we know who God is speaking to? Whether it's being a part of our fellowship or something else, how does the Christian know how to evaluate the claims of somebody who says, I have heard from God. Well, in truth, we don't always know, not right here, but we can certainly know the humble people who seek to serve and to love rather than the arrogant poser who interviews for a position. We know who is more in line with the meek and repentant soul who follows Jesus and worships Him in spirit and in truth. Jesus, filled with the Spirit, did not pridefully beat his chest and tell God, I can't hear you if you're telling me that I've got to go and fast in the wildest part of the wilderness with nothing but beasts and dust and stones. I want to go to those beautiful city buildings with the well-to-do people and be richly paid to dispense my wisdom and administer their 501c3 nonprofit corporations. Jesus felt the Holy Spirit of his Almighty Father driving him to the most desolate parts of Judea. For 40 days, Jesus lived without a bite to eat. Now, I could stand to go on a fast or two or three myself, but a 40-day fast could kill you, especially in an arid wilderness. I'll just say, don't attempt a fast without consulting a physician or without some people who can check you on it, without doing some research. If you've never done it before, let me phrase this gently, with all Christian compassion, don't be stupid. Do your research. Consult with people experienced. Don't be stupid. Fasting and prayer is a good thing. Medically, there are wonderful benefits to fasting. And spiritually, there are some great benefits too. But if your health is fragile, if you're not in decent shape, if you've never done this before and don't know much about it, don't even think about a protracted, severe fast on your own. You probably won't make it anyway, but don't injure your health and don't risk problems if you're not ready for it. Now, let's say that you are well acquainted with fasting and prayer in solitude, and while I confess that I obviously am not someone who has done a lot of fasting, let's say you know what you're doing, and let's say you do it safely, and you do it frequently enough to do it right, and for the right reasons. You want to subdue your flesh. You want to strengthen your mind or your spirit. You want to sacrifice your comfort for a time, gain the physical benefits of fasting and cleansing your body, and you want to draw closer to God through some serious prayer and meditation on His Word, where you're not even thinking about breakfast at the Waffle House. Are you prepared for a time of hard temptation? You might never fast, but you will face temptation, and that can come at any time. Jesus was prepared. Jesus was so prepared that God, through His Holy Spirit, after opening up the view of heaven itself to His Son, then drove him into the wilderness to face direct temptation by the darkest and most seductive evil in the universe. Oh, Jesus was prepared. And we can be prepared to face and to defeat temptation and Satan in the same way that Jesus was. You can prevail against the gates of hell, and Jesus has already shown us the way. Now, it is easy for us to think, and particularly for me to think, well, Jesus was Jesus. I'm just me. He was the Son of God. I'm just stupid, sinful, backsliding, dumb, old, clumsy, bad old me. How can I hope to defeat the devil, the god of this world, the prince of the power of the air, the father of lies, the ruler of darkness? The darkness itself that seeks to overtake the light, the old serpent, the great dragon, Satan himself. We were created a little lower than the angels. We can't match them in our power. What can I do? How can I do what Jesus did and defeat that cunning, evil, overwhelming spirit? It seems impossible. But with God all things are possible, and in James 4:7 we are told, submit yourselves, therefore, to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. So, first of all, Jesus was in that position to be tempted of Satan because he was submitted to God. He loves to shoot down Christians who are submitted to God. Jesus wasn't seeking temptation, and he did not make provision for sin. Satan came looking for Jesus and brought sin and temptation with him. Secondly, Jesus was resisting Satan. He knew he was being tempted. He knew what spirit was doing it. We are told to use Scripture to test the spirits that whisper to us. If you have a yen or a yearning that is opposed to what the Word of God says, you can be sure that God is not the one telling you to do it. Each time that Satan tempted Jesus, the Son of God knew how to answer the old serpent. Satan tempted him to use the miraculous power of God to feed himself, to make bread from stone, as easily as he later made wine from water, and then still later fed thousands with just the brown bread and small fish from a boy's lunch. But God had not told Jesus that his time of temptation and fasting was over in the first temptation. Right then and there, Jesus told us the great secret to triumphant Christian living, and that is to nourish ourselves on the Word of God and not to be so concerned with the things of this world. That's a theme you hear from Jesus a lot. Well, Satan, that old dragon, then transported Jesus to a high tower on the great temple and tempted him to step out onto thin air. Now, he could have done that with a high mountain. Later, he transports Jesus to a high mountain. But this was the temple, right in the middle, the heart of the holy city, and where everybody would see. You can see the pinnacles from the temple from almost everywhere in Jerusalem during that time. And certainly thousands of people would have been there in the courtyards. Everyone would have seen it if Jesus had stepped out into thin air, uplifted by angels at his command. They would have fallen on their faces, worshiping him right then and there with no question that Jesus was Lord. Except that this was not God's plan for Jesus. He had prophesied what needed to happen. He did not want Jesus to simply overwhelm the free will of all men with a public and supernatural miracle of that kind. He wanted people coming to him in repentance and of their own free will. Later, Jesus did ascend into the heavens, with only a few hundred to see it, but he didn't do it before the whole city, in the heart of Judaism. Then, the God of this world offered Jesus the worship and rule over all the world, outright, through his own dark supernatural power. No humiliation, no trials, no beatings, no crucifixion. No, Satan knew that that wasn't something that even Jesus Christ would look forward to. Jesus later prayed, God, if there's any way, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Satan knew, finally, exactly how to get to Jesus. All you have to do to avoid all that and still have everything is just submit one time. Each time, Jesus resisted with the power of the Word of God. And that final time, he commanded Satan to leave, and he did. And here's the great part. We are assured in God's word, and we can tell you from the experience of the millions and millions of Christians who have gone before, who have seen this in their own lives, we can do the same. We can say, get thee behind me, Satan. We can say, go away from here. God's word tells me not to do that. And the more we do that, the easier it is as we are more and more conformed to the image of Christ, as we take up our cross each and every day, as we present ourselves, our selfish selves, as living sacrifices, we become more like Jesus. You know, and after a time of trial, the angels cared for Jesus, and you can be sure he needed it after all he had been through just then. And God cares for us too. He may not send angels down for us to see and know, but he'll send your brothers and sisters in Christ. He cares for you, and he'll make sure that those around you in your fellowship care for you too, as you all grow closer to one another, as you grow closer to Jesus. It was after that great temptation, that great boot camp that Jesus went through, that his ministry was underway in earnest. And we can see that in our own lives. As we study God's word, as we defeat Satan, as we resist the devil, as he flees from us, and as we find ways through God's word to overcome the temptations that beset us, that is when our ministries, like Jesus' ministry, will take off. And I'm not talking about your ministry in the pulpit. You probably don't sit in the pulpit, do you, or stand in the pulpit. You're probably one of those out in the congregation. You have a ministry too. Resist the devil. Use God's word. And that old dragon will flee. And your life in Christ and the things that you will be able to do and accomplish, whether you know it or not, in the kingdom of heaven are going to be wonderful.